The day started out very warm. And at some point around midday, suddenly this enormous wind came. It was like within minutes, trees are just whoosh, like this, branches snapping, trees coming down, and it kept on going and going and going for like about 8 hours. And now it suddenly has calmed down, and I tell you, the atmosphere here is probably the best atmosphere I've ever felt here. It is like tropical, but you know, just amazing, amazing atmosphere. We have several weeks plus before the election, before what is guaranteed to be upheaval, no matter who wins, guaranteed to be upheaval. And so what we are doing is we are aiming past that, to somehow just blow right past that and get a big boost. A big boost can come in several ways. Someone who's here in this world who has perfect certitude would be an enormously huge boost. Or those who are getting comfortable with certitude can also give us a big boost. Those are most of the teachers in the world are getting comfortable with certitude. They're getting more and more and more comfortable. Okay. And it is rare to see anyone in this world who has perfect certitude, effortless, seamless, no possibility of losing that certitude. Those are the Ramanas, the Jesuses, the Anandamayas, the Buddhas, those types who there's no possibility for a moment that they're not in perfect knowing. Perfect knowing. The rest of the teachers are getting comfortable with certitude and getting moving towards that point where they will have this effortless, seamless certitude. They don't even need to meditate or anything. It is, that's all that there is with them. That's all that there is certitude, nothing other than that. So we can get big boost from both of those. And I expect that we will, because it really will be necessary. There has to be some type of momentum, which means certitude is present. Certitude is present. To some extent, there's a comfort zone with certitude, a real comfort zone that is powerful. And that will lift us up. Lift us up, like as if we were floating past this whole situation that's coming up in the world. We will really be lifted up into a comfort zone, comfort with certitude. We will have the opportunity to get comfortable with it, which isn't so much a conceptual thing. It's not. It's different. It's a wow thing. It is a wow thing, really. So get ready for that wow. It simply takes your breath away. There's a difference. There's a difference. I remember, here's an analogy. I've been out on a lot of beautiful golf courses. And one day I went out on just this, my favorite amazing golf course. It was 5 o'clock, 5:30 in the morning, crack of dawn. And there was this tropical storm had come through. And it was little raindrops kind of were drizzling down. And there was some moisture on the ground. The sun was coming through the clouds and this brilliant sunrise. And I was out all alone there, first one out. And I got out there, and the whole atmosphere and just the feel, everything was so incredible that it took my breath away. It took my breath away. I could hardly breathe. All I could think of was, wow. That's it. No other thoughts. There were no thoughts entering my mind at all. It's just like, just wanting to be here forever. You know, I just was just like, this could last forever. It is so wonderful. It is so fantastic. Wow. Wow. Okay. Haven't had that since. That is like a wow moment. And we, on the spiritual path, we can have those wow moments. We deserve it. Those of us who have been working so hard deserve that. We have to believe, not believe, but we have to know that we deserve it. We deserve it. We have to know that. That's beyond conceptual. Where we just say, oh my gosh, wow. There's something here that is just beyond belief. That is better than anything belief can give us. And it's here, it's right here. And that is that wow moment. That is sufficient to literally move us past the times that are to come for those who are following along with belief. And believe in belief, but are still attached to belief. And belief has an entire belief system. Within that belief system, there are believed in gods, or a god, a believed in god, believed in gods, believed in goddesses, believed in entities, believed in persons, personas, people, bodies. All stuff is believed in by belief. None of it is true. None of it is true. Fundamentally, belief believes in impermanence, that there's nothing that is permanent. Permanence is impossible. That's what belief believes in. Believe us. Belief does not believe that there are immutable laws of reality. Belief believes that everything can be changed. No such thing as immutability. Therefore, no such thing as reality. So it is believed in its own kingdom, the kingdom of belief. And in this kingdom, their belief has a god that is believing it. It has all these entities that it's imagine making up, believing in this, believed in god, imaginary god. See, what we are is not our persona or a person or anything like that. What we are is certitude itself, inclusiveness itself, invulnerability, eternal life itself, flawless, effortless experiencing itself, direct experiencing itself, abiding in immutable laws of reality. That is what we are, always have been, and always will be. But the belief has believed, imagine up a whole kingdom of all this people and bodies and worlds and worshiping deities and God and all this stuff, has simply believed it all. Believed it all. It's only belief. It's only belief. No truth to it whatsoever. Within this kingdom of belief, the ultimate purpose is to figure out a way to destroy reality and force the prime creator to change reality. And therefore, you have upheaval, turmoil. You have everything that is stressing impermanence, stressing vulnerability. Vulnerability is stressed in this belief system we call existence. And so you will find just the most... I took a look at some of the stuff just recently. Just checked in a little bit at what's going on around the on the internet as far as people, what their attitudes are. So, oh man, wow! I told you, it's going to be just insane, just insane. You know, if this one wins, or if this one wins, you know, either way, the madness. The push towards vulnerability to attack, prove vulnerability, etc., is going off the charts. It's going off the charts. This is a serious situation. I've known it's going to be a serious situation my whole life. I knew it would come to this eventually, and it's going to come to that, which is why I've continued to press forward as fast as possible my whole life towards a big boost, which means wow factor. Have to have a wow factor. Have to have it. Now, getting used to the teachers we have in this world now is a very helpful thing, because they have a certain amount of wow factor. Some. It can get better. It can get better. I know that for a fact. Not to disrespect any teacher in the world. All I'm saying is it can get better. I know this for a fact, because I have really, for a long, long time, studied the life of Ananda Mayama, for instance, and know the whole situation backwards and forwards. And that was a top wow factor. And it is more than we have now. It is more. And there are those actually in this world who went to see her from the West even, and they've given reports, and the wow factor was just unbelievable, really. There was like this field of certitude, and this wow factor extended for miles around her. She would come to a place, and for miles around her, all of nature would calm down, all the people would calm down, the whole area, for miles, would be in this state of tranquility and peace. It was just incredible. And so I'm well aware that there is, we should not give up hope at any point in this world. If we feel our wow factor is not up, not where it should be, we should not give up hope, because it definitely has happened before where there can be a wow factor that can literally lift us up beyond any of the troubles that belief is bringing upon itself, self-inflicted troubles, which belief is going to inflict itself with enormous grief coming up. And if we are still hooked on belief and not disengaged from belief, we are really going to suffer. Anyone, myself included, if I don't get free, disengaged from belief, I'm going to suffer terribly too. But if we get a major boost, a wow factor boost, jaw-dropping, just like, whoa, the mind just stops, you know, just whoa. And then your breath almost stops, just like, and you're silent, just silent. You don't even want to say anything. That will lift us up past all of the grief that belief is going to inflict upon itself, upon belief. It's not inflicting on reality at all. Never has and never will. So I have really dedicated my life to knowing and expecting this wow factor to come into the world. I really have been expecting it. It hasn't come yet. Not that I'm not aware of it. Not this real, real wow factor just stops you in your tracks. And then you just realize, whoa, this belief, all this belief is phony. It's all false. It's all false. It becomes crystal clear and apparent. You know it. You know it. At that point, there's a knowing. And that knowing is the wow. Wow. You say, I know. Now I know. Now I know. It's not belief. It's knowing. I know it. I know it. I know it. I know it. So from my perspective, all the teachers in the world have been getting us ready for an even bigger boost. That is how I look at it. I respect all the teachers and everything that they've done. And I've received a lot of boost from some of them. But I see it as getting us ready for a big boost. Okay? That's what happened in India. There's a lot of teachers in India. And then Ananda Mayamma came on the scene. And all those teachers in India that met her, they just said, wow. They literally did. The teachers, then, they're very respected, high-ranking teachers. I mean, Yogananda, for instance, high-ranking teacher. When he met Ananda Mayamma, he just said, wow. Wow, wow, wow. He says, I don't know if I've ever met anyone like this at all, who is seamlessly, perpetually, every moment in the highest bliss. In other words, perfect certitude. He was just like, wow, you know, and that's just one example of many, 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 many. Sivananda up there in Rishikesh, very high-ranking teacher, very well-known, and Ananda Mayamma to him is just like, wow. Ram Dass down in southern India, same thing. He met Ananda Mayamma and just like, wow, wow, you know, this is like, well, to them, it's even wow. So, what happens when a place builds up the spiritual dharma, the sadhana, spiritual practice, the inquiry, when there's a lot of teachers, which there are a lot of teachers in the West and around the world right now who've been doing good work, very good work. They've been doing holding satsang, inquiry, all of this. And they're building up this readiness for what I call is the big boost. The big boost. And that's when someone arrives on the scene who even the top teachers in the world say, wow, 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 wow. And then the whole thing gets elevated. The whole thing gets elevated. The entire spiritual effort of clarity that we've been engaging in, the whole thing gets lifted up like that. It really does. And that's when underneath all the chaos and anarchy is happening, and it doesn't touch us, doesn't touch us. Now, this is something I have studied very carefully, of how does a culture, a world get lifted up when things are absolutely falling to pieces. And it is through preparation. That term belief is not good. I believe that's not good. It's apparent. It's very apparent to my clarity. It's very apparent that there has been an enormous upgrade in the spiritual wisdom of the West over the last 100 years. You know, you have Krishnamurti, you have Ramana Maharshi, you have Yogananda, you have many Papaji, you have many, many, you know, Ram Dass, and a lot of teachers in a lot of different ways, from all these different types of teachers, from many traditions, have been cultivating the soil and bringing more and more wisdom, spiritual wisdom to the West, more and more wisdom. It's just that right now we're at a point where we're recognizing that it's somehow, there's been a corollary to that. And the corollary is that the world, the belief is getting more and more intense, building up, and it's become more and more demanding, more and more attractive, and what it's caused the whole situation to be teetering on the abyss, really. We've kind of like stagnated because, I mean, having gone through the 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, all this big push, and then into this next century, there were times when we really felt like we were really going to get over the top, and we didn't. As a culture, as those engaged in spiritual inquiry, et cetera, it sort of has stagnated. It has sort of stagnated. It really has. And it's sort of been teetering, you know, as belief puts this massive, massive effort to trip us all up. Massive effort. It's an incredible effort is taking place in this world to get us to forsake the attraction to certainty within us. And so we've ended up kind of seeming to be feeble. But it must be that within a lot of us, there is this capability to respond to the wow factor. There's a capability there to respond to it, because there's so many teachers and so much work done. And, you know, a lot of those teachers say, well, nobody's really got it, you know, nobody's quite got it. And sometimes these teachers, they kind of get pulled back down, you know, end up having feet of clay, and it's been a very tough situation, very tough. It's like we haven't been able to get to the mountaintop. We haven't really reached where we want to go yet. And now if you look at what's going to happen after the election, the U.S. election, you know, it is just going to be awful. The situations are just, the world economy is in terrible condition, really. They just keep printing money and more and more and more money, more and more money. But underneath, it's rotten. There's too much speculation in the whole system. Too much greed and too much speculation. And that's a recipe for disaster. And the speculation is just out of control. And the way that computers are being used, et cetera, and just the greed of people, they're not spiritually grounded. They're not grounded in inquiry. So what else do they have to do except try to get as much as possible? Get, you see? And now with these new tools, they have been able to speculate far into the future and just do more and more speculation. It foams everything up, and desperate attempts to keep propping it up by printing more money. So we are headed into a situation that is so polarized that it requires a big boost. We require it. It's a requirement at this time. I have to be very straightforward. It is a requirement, because the teachers of today, what I see, without a big boost, don't have what it takes to really lift us up, lift the culture up, lift the whole spiritual situation up, so that we can bypass it, you know, to lift it all up. Because that literally takes a very powerful wow factor, very powerful at this time, because the situation is so terrible. and for the to the best of my ability, and searching among so many teachers in the world, I have not found that wow factor that is sufficient. I have not found it. And so we cannot afford to continue on business as usual, spiritual business as usual. It's not going to be good enough. It is not. Because belief is going to start beating itself up. Really, really, belief is a suicidal maniac, you know. Really, belief is a complete maniac. It'll go berserk. Belief is going to go berserk. It really will. And it thinks this is salvation. And so it's incredibly difficult when belief goes berserk. If we have any, you know, without being lifted up, that is going to tug at us and pull at us, because belief is an incredible rascal, very deceptive. And we're so used to it. We are so used to belief that even though we can see through it conceptually, very clear, it is simply like a bad habit. It is like a bad habit. That, you know, it's like someone who's been smoking all their life and they know it's killing them. And they know they should stop. And no matter what they try, they just can't stop. We have this terrible habit. And they try patches, they try, you know, gut nicotine gum, they try all this stuff. But when push comes to shove and that stress gets super bad, you know, they're back to smoking. We're like that. We can get a lot of clarity. And we can have good teachers, etc. But when things get really stressful, when belief goes berserk, we're going to go back to the habits that belief has inculcated in us throughout the eons as to where can we get some kind of satisfaction. And we're going to grab at straws, we'll be clutching at the straws of satisfaction, the belief that we're used to. Searching in the flesh, in bodies, in external things, etc., all that kind of stuff. We'll just be, you know, having our attention, you know, pulled in that direction, which is disaster. It's a disaster. So what I've consistently said throughout my life is that a big boost will come and we have to prepare for it. When I was young, I told everybody that I could. I said there's going to be a great big boost in the form of a book. A form of book-based teaching that is going to come into the world. And I looked at all the teachings in the world and I said, you know, something's going to be even better than this. My dad had a library of all the best spiritual books in the world. And even when I was young, I would read. I was constantly reading spiritual books. And I said, you know what? These are good, you know, helpful, but the times are such that are coming that these are not enough. But the good news is that we will have something better coming in very soon. Is this microphone working? It is not. For some reason, I did not get the right microphone on. No, it is on. Weird. Okay. And then I discovered eventually A Course in Miracles, which is a superior teaching. It is a superior teaching. Now this is working differently than before. I fear that the audio wasn't right before. I mean, it is a clearer teaching. It is more useful teaching for the times. I don't know if I can say it's superior because other times required other teachings, but it is an extremely useful thing. So I was aware that I was right. I was vindicated that now I'm saying that there's going to be a big boost. I've been saying that for 20 years, maybe, that there's going to be a really, really big boost in the world, maybe in the form of someone, or maybe several in this world with perfect certitude. And that will literally give us enough boost to not be vulnerable, to have our attention pulled down into belief. It will enable that, because we will be in a wow factor condition. And it'll you know, we'll be like woof, 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 you know, reverberating. There will be reverberation. We will be reverberating.
And we're just in the middle, you know, we're the center of this reverberation. It's like a bell. It's like a huge bell gets rung, you know. That's what people said. Those who are really well prepared, they met Ananda Maimon. They said it was like a bell, like they were a bell, and suddenly she struck the bell, and the whole their bell is just reverberating, just massive reverberation, and they're just sitting there quietly in the middle of that reverberation. And there is something that happens that simply enables one to flow past anything that all the belief going berserk cannot touch you, cannot touch you. So we are most certainly praying for that and expecting it, because there is this dynamic when belief goes berserk. Berserk, okay, you can look it up. That's what happens. Belief goes berserk. There's no rhyme or reason to it whatsoever. It is simply, it just seems like the world has gone mad, just gone mad. And when that happens, there has to be, you have to be reverberating, you know. You have to be. You have to have something going on with you that is transcendent, that is a felt certitude, a felt certitude that reality is real and belief is not real. There has to be a felt certitude to it, and it has to take on depth to it. I remember eating that ghost pepper. I was eating hot sauce, Tabasco sauce, you know, habanero sauce stuff. It's hot. It burns your mouth. Okay, I get that. Eating that ghost pepper, it was like ringing a bell. Like my whole body was like a bell had been rung, and it was reverberating. It's completely different. Completely different. And it was like, wow, this is beyond hot. This is way beyond hot. And it's like that. Conceptuality is like heat, you know. It's like Tabasco sauce and habanero stuff. It's you can get it hot, but the big boost is like a ghost pepper, you know. It reverberates. It's beyond belief. It is beyond belief. The feeling is like, wow, I'm experiencing something that's beyond belief. And that is what we deserve, because we are beyond belief. We deserve it. 100% deserve it. But we've always been perfectly included in reality. Always. Full membership in reality. Without any possibility of ever being excluded. So how can we not deserve it? Only belief believes that it doesn't deserve it. Which is true. Because belief is nothing. It's just a denial of deservedness. So a denial of deservedness cannot accept deservedness. Denial of certitude cannot accept certitude. It will flee from it. It will reject it. So belief will flee from it. And in that fleeing, that's like the Passover principle. When you have certitude, belief will flee from you. It doesn't want to have anything to do with you. And it's only if you try to chase after belief, that's when you get into trouble. But belief will absolutely flee from you. Like you were the annihilator itself of belief, which is like light is the annihilator of darkness. It's more than just darkness, is the absence of light. It's not like there's anything there with darkness. So it's not like, and with belief, there's nothing there. There's no there. So I continue to beat the drum for a situation that should take place. We should get a big boost, because Lord knows we are going to get, belief is going to go berserk. Because people are going to look at the future and say, hey, I don't want that future at all. And others will say, we're going to force you to accept that future. And others will say, there's no way you're going to force us to have that future. And then, you know, and just the attitudes of people, the way that this culture has been, the comfort zone, they've been shifting their comfort zone towards what? Towards violence. Towards a casual acceptance of the worst types of violence possible through all the games, the television, the movies, the books, the magazines, the video games, the entire setup in this world now has gotten so many sports, like the NFL, for instance, which, by the way, is a tax-exempt organization, doesn't pay taxes. I mean, gets people used to, you know, extreme violence. People are getting used, more and more used to it. Young people, again, like the older people, like in Mexico, are terrified of the younger people. Even the older criminals are terrified of the younger people. The younger people have been raised on these totally violent video games, and to them, it's funny. They laugh when they commit atrocities. They have no conscience anymore. So the world has been set up to go berserk. It really has. And, you know, the people who don't see that will be shocked. I say, how can the human beings be acting this way? We asked the same question of the Germans, didn't we? And the Japanese in World War II. How can human beings act this way, you know? Like, you know, just beyond, you know, just horrible. How can they? Because they were conditioned beforehand. That's the only way. They were conditioned beforehand. They lost all civility. They were trained to become haters. They were trained to that life was cheap, that they were that these others were, you know, subhuman and all this kind of thing, you know, that the and it goes beyond that, that beliefs that the, you know, getting rid of those who seem to be attracted to certitude helps everyone move towards salvation, so they're just doing everyone a favor. It goes on and on and on. So the world is absolutely set up to go berserk right now. All it takes is a triggering event, and the election is going to be a triggering event. It can't help but be at this point. So that's why I've been in a race against time, and many of you also feeling this, like, uh-oh, you know, wow, we better get some sort of boost coming up. And as far as how well this idea has gone out to the world, it hasn't gone out well. No matter what I have tried to put this idea out there in the past, it has not been picked up. It has not been picked up. Why? Because people have this false hope that everything's going to be fine in the world, and they say, we don't really need that big boost. Not yet. Okay, just like I've told you that Christians always say, Jesus, we want you coming back, but just not today, not yet, we're not quite ready. Why? Because they're hoping that they don't need the big boost, because they're kind of scared. I don't blame anyone. I'm scared. Absolutely, are you kidding? You come across a perfect certitude, you know, you're going to reverberate. And, you know, getting your bell rung is, I guess you could say it's a little unexpected. Getting your spiritual bell rung is unexpected. And you know, we haven't had it. You know, there's a first time for everything, right? But until you have that first time, you're going to be kind of like trying to avoid it. So people don't want to think about this, that there's a big boost coming. They want to believe that everything's going to be fine in the world. Not so bad. Be able to skate through it. You know, the ice is in, but it's not going to break. But it's going to break. So we do have to prepare for this as best we can. And I'm certainly hoping that this idea can start catching on. I don't know if it will or not, because again, you know, all it takes is for some people to just see it how it is, and to be able to admit that they're scared of it. Yeah, but that's okay. You know, that's okay. and just say, yeah, okay, it's inevitable that I would be kind of nervous about it, but that's okay. Okay, let me be nervous. Being nervous is okay. That's all right. It's not a problem. Not a problem. I don't have to be totally cool with it, you know? I can say, yeah, okay, that's something that needs to happen, and I'm a little bit nervous about it, but that can't stop, you know, preparation for it, aiming for that. It cannot stop it. So honesty again is the greatest help there is on the path. Just saying, yeah, we're gonna need it. Two, I'm nervous about it. Three, I need to get a little bit more okay with it. That kind of thing. The one, two, three. I'm still working on it. I'm still nervous about it. Absolutely. Absolutely. I try to, you know, imagine getting the spiritual bell rung, where you just go into wow mode, complete wow mode. And it's off the charts. I mean, conceptually, it's off the charts. It's off the conceptual charts. And it's sort of like uncharted territory. It is. You can't get that with drugs. You cannot get it. You know, a lot of people in the 60s, what happens? They tried to prepare for it through drugs. Okay, let's just again tell it like it really is, because I've been there, done it, the whole thing, seen the whole situation. I mean, there were some super gurus in India during that time, during last century, and people were getting their bell rung, and it filtered throughout the world. And there was this whole upsurge, you know, in spiritual aspiration, you know, realizing, hey, there's help is here, help is here. Because the times were quite bad back then, actually, with the world wars, and then the Cold War, and then the Vietnam War conflict, you know, times were, and there's a lot of protests. I mean, the free speech movement, the civil rights movement, I mean, it was really, really wild. And people were searching for you know, to rise above the situation. And, you know, we weren't ready. People weren't ready in the West to get their spiritual bell rung. Not many were. Not many were. And so what people tried to do was ring their bell with drugs, trying, thinking like this is going to help them get ready for it. You know, it doesn't. It does not. Absolutely does not. It didn't work for anybody. It did not work for anybody. Those teachers, those ambassadors of certitude, always say, do not take any drugs. Don't use drugs to try and get over your, you know, fear and nervousness of getting your spiritual bell rung. Do not do it. Do not do it. That is a big mistake. Because it doesn't work. And you get your bell rung, but it's not your spiritual bell that's rung. It's your perceptual bell. Yeah, but it's not in a spiritual way. It's not in certitude. It's not certitude ringing the bell at all. It's just altering perception in various ways that just ends up, you know, it. I mean, the number of those who tried that, who have gone downhill, is legion. It's absolute legion. And I said, hey. You know, that doesn't work. You know, people said, well, what do you know? You know, and I said, no, you got to spend your time in genuine inquiry to prepare for that. And, you know, flush the drugs down the toilet. You know, that's not gonna get the job done. You have some hard work to do. You know, you have to really get the work done. And so those who have done that, you know, they're in a position now where they literally can get their spiritual bell rung, and they'll be okay with it. They'll be okay with it, and then they will literally help raise up, you know, the whole spiritual climate of the world will be raised up, because there are a lot of people throughout the world, sprinkled throughout the world, who are capable of responding and getting their spiritual bell rung. Though there can be a whole domino effect that can take place. It's not going to stop the mayhem in the world. World going berserk, it won't stop it. It won't stop it. But it will lift many up so that it passes them by, and even greater situations are to come. Really, it is stupendous what is to come for those who have prepared properly. And it is my good fortune to have my bell rung many times during sleep, coming across these great teachers of certitude, interacting with them many, many times. It definitely rang my bell when I wake up in the morning. It was just like, wow, you know, I couldn't believe it. It was beyond belief, the interaction I had while I was asleep. As far as waking time, nothing really has happened. Waking time, have not had my bell rung that. Even though I've seen some notable teachers in this world, nothing happened. So when you get your, spiritual bell rung in sleep, when you wake up in the morning, you realize, wow, this can happen. This really can happen, and you get clued into it. And you start preparing for something even more substantial to come, which is exactly what I've been doing. And there is a way to prepare for it as far as clarity goes, but not a way to prepare for it entirely. It's kind of like taking a shower. It's not the same thing as diving into a swimming pool. Drinking some water is not the same thing into a swimming pool. It's not the same. Or walking in the rain, you know. It's just not the same as diving into a swimming pool. There's nothing quite like that, you know. So we can only prepare to a certain extent. To a certain extent. And so we shouldn't get frustrated by the fact that we still feel like, I haven't got it yet. I haven't got it yet. Shouldn't get frustrated. Because there is that, still that gap will still be there to going beyond belief. There is that gap. There is that gap between your clarifications and understandings and the wow factor. Just the whole wow factor. There is a gap. you can touch upon it. You can touch upon it. It's not quite the same as when you truly come across perfect certitude that rings your bell, rings your spiritual bell, the bell of remembrance. It rings the bell of remembrance really strongly. It's a no doubt about it situation. And, at that point, the argument drops away. You know that certitude is still certain. And that belief has never done anything to it. Never done anything to it at all. And you can't help but be struck by this, you know. Through and through. You can't help it. So, you know, somebody has to go first. I'll go first if I have to. You know, nobody really wants to go first. Whoever goes first is fine. I don't care. Any of you can go first. I'm perfectly happy. If you can find perfect certitude and get your bell of remembrance rung, your spiritual bell of remembrance rung, then that'll be, you know, tremendous, tremendous. You're welcome to it. It doesn't matter who goes first. It really doesn't. It's just that there needs to be that process needs to get underway. And if I have to go first, you know, so be it. I don't care one way or the other. And the more that go, the easier it is for others. They see and say, ah, it's not so bad. If they can do it, surely I can, you know. It's like that. I mean, if I can do it, I'm sure you can, you know. Who am I in the world? Nobody. Nobody. You know, don't have any status. So if I can do it, you can do it. And as you do it, others will look at you and say, ah, they did it. I can do it too. It's like that. So, you know, really, it might be better if just ordinary people do it. I mean, those who don't have any spiritual status whatsoever, who haven't published any books, who haven't put out any DVDs, who don't have, you know, devotees, who, you know, all this stuff, who don't have anything of that, just, you know, nobodies who have just been grinding away, clarifying, you know, they can get it. They can get it. If they can get it, the others will say, hey, I can too, because I'm a nobody too. I don't have any status. You know, there's those who are, you know, holding retreats. They have ashrams and retreats, many books, and, you know, just the whole thing. They have it all, you know, all that whole spirituality situation. You know, they're known factors. And you may be unknown, completely unknown, no status. But if you can get it, just think how many others that are just like that, you know, and they'll say, you know what? I can do it too. It's not just for, you know, the big wig teachers. It's not just for them either. It's not. It's kind of like those who realize they need to take refuge are the ones who will be blessed. You know, the ones who are humble enough to say, hey, you know, I need help. This world situation, I'm going to need help. No question about it. I can't do it on my own. I'm not sufficiently advanced with my comfort level with certainty to skate through the situation. I'm going to fall through the ice. Too heavy. You know, you're really heavy. You'll fall through the ice. Into the cold water. So it's those who say, hey, I need help, who will seek the help, find the help, and get helped. Where maybe there might be some of the world who, you know, I had a situation, my own dad, my own father, was looked up to by quite a few people, and he was unable to ask for help because they thought he was didn't need any help, that he was, you know, he had it, and so I asked him, you know, what's going on, how come? And he says, I'm trapped because I got this image, and everyone's believing in this image that I know it all, and I don't, but I can't let them know that, because then they will really be upset with me or something. You know, it was really tough trap. So sometimes the spiritual teachers of the world are kind of in a trap because they cannot admit to their devotees that they need help. Because the devotees say, well, wait a minute, we're asking you for help. And you're saying, you know, you're the one that needs help? What's going on here? See, it is a problem. It is a problem. I don't see any teacher on this planet that doesn't need some help. I really don't. I've not seen one teacher on this planet that couldn't use some help, a big boost, you know. Not one. And I don't know how many of them will say, hey, you know what? I need myself. I could use a big boost. That would be humility. That would, you know, which would be great. Would be great. It would be honesty. It'd be humility. It would be being real about everything, about the situation. My prayers are that none of them are trapped. You know, the way my dad was trapped. I saw it firsthand. I know the situation firsthand, very, very firsthand. And truth is that there's an undercurrent. In any spiritual situation in this world, there's an undercurrent of belief still there. And this belief is desperate for there not to be 100% certitude. It's desperate for it. And it will put up with a certain degree of certitude, but it will dig its heels in to keep us from going to perfect certitude. It digs its heels in. And, you know, you can attract devotees, thousands, millions, But the undercurrent is they're willing to worship you as long as you don't go into perfect certitude, you see. But if you to say, hey, I need some help because I'm not in perfect certitude in that situation now, I need a boost, they're going to say that you're a false teacher, you know. They'll turn on you. The belief will turn on you. Belief will turn on you at that point. So it is a dangerous thing to... Being a teacher can be a dangerous thing. It really can. It's a tough situation. You have to be humble. You have to be humble. Because the devotees will say, no, you're it. You're it. And you know you're not it. You know you're not 100%. You don't have perfect certitude. You're moving your comfort zone towards perfect certitude, which is you have enormous charisma and grace is pouring off of you. Absolutely, yeah. But you don't have perfect certitude yet. It's not, you haven't, you know. So devotees will come and they'll say, hey, this is good enough. We want you just as you are. You're it. You're the greatest. What they're saying is, don't go any further. Stop right there. Don't, no more. Don't go to all the way. Don't go all the way. So they can end up being trapped. Absolutely happens. Happened many times. My dad got over cancer. I mean, the cancer receded and backed off because the Passover principle worked for him. It backed off like that within a couple days. He was at death's door in a couple days. He was eating like crazy and feeling good, and it got better and better. And I said, why don't you just live with it that way? It's just in a backed-off condition. In other words, that belief attacking itself was in a backed-off condition. It couldn't kill him. Could not. But he said, no, I can't do it because the people that are following me, they want me to be 100% well. They want to see me heal myself. And that's what they're looking for, 100%. And they will not tolerate me just living with it in a backed-off condition. And I said, that's trouble. It's not going to work. It's not going to work. And it didn't work. It didn't work. And, you know, he knew he was trapped. He was caught in a trap and couldn't quite see the way out of it. I could see it, but I couldn't quite, you know, completely convey it. Sometimes you just have to live with stuff in a backed-off condition. As you continue to get comfortable with your certitude, you know, illnesses will keep trying to get you. Stuff will keep trying to get you, and it'll back away. I have that happening to me just recently. You know, some kind of illness trying to grab me. I was able to move forward, and it backs away, but it wants to come back. And I say, hey, sorry, I just have to live with it. You know, that's what happens. That is what happens. And if you try to put yourself up as a perfect teacher, you're going to get trapped, because the devotees will say, you're perfect. We want you to be perfect. And therefore, you cannot accept help from anyone else because we think you're the highest. What's really going on is they know you're not the highest, and they want to keep you that way. Okay? That is what is really happening. Because they themselves are scared. They are scared of certitude. And they want to end. They're lazy. They're lazy. Plain and simple. Those who just go to a teacher and say, you know, you're the one, you're perfect, and so I'll, you know, I don't have to do anything more. Well, that's fine if the teacher truly has perfect certitude, because then the teacher will be able to tell them, yeah, you do have to do a lot more, or whatever needs to be told, they can do it. No problem. But when you when they go to someone who doesn't have perfect certitude yet and say, you are it, you're perfect, you're the highest teacher, they're really saying that they're making a deal with the teacher. We'll say you're the highest teacher if we don't have to do the hard work, the tough work. Because who wants to do the tough work? Nobody. Nobody does. You know, who wants to dig the ditches? Nobody. You can tell, you know, I can tell working, I can tell who's doing the work, who's in there really doing the work, who's going to do the work, the ditch digging, you know. You build a house, there's a lot of ditches that have to be dug for all the electrical and the irrigation and some of the plumbing. A lot of stuff has to be, ditches have to be dug, earth has to be moved, you know, and it doesn't happen by itself. And some people, you know, don't want to do the ditch digging. And so they'd rather, you know, make a deal with someone and say, we'll worship you as perfect certitude if you tell us that we don't have to do the ditch digging. But if you come across a teacher, one who is in perfect certitude, ambassador of certitude, perfect, flawless, then that can ring your bell of remembrance, and you absolutely, that can just be, you can just reverberate it. Situation can change. It can change. The grace there is sufficient. It's amazing grace there. It can really, really be a game changer. It is a game changer. In many cases, it is a game changer. And at that point, you are able to be in touch with the certitude that is all there is. And it's no longer, you know, the situation is no longer simply one of worshiping a teacher, a guru, or something like that. It sort of transcends that entire situation. So, if you have the humility to ask for help, you're actually in the best situation possible. Or you can say, absolutely, I need help. I think there's really trouble coming. I want help. I need help. I really am looking for help. I expect help. I want it. And I'm a little nervous about it, but, you know, that's fine. That's fine. What do we expect? You know, it's a nervous time. Very nervous time. So I'm doing my best here to generate some momentum towards positive expectations. I say the best is yet to come. The best is yet to come. An evening like this is, you know, incredible. Has wow factor. This evening is so incredible. Has wow factor. I mean, what is this? October? I don't know. It's the 18th. It's the 18th. What do we have left? 13 days. We have 19 days until election day. 19th day will be election day. A little less than 3 weeks. Here we have this incredible evening. It's a wow factor evening, and we're talking about the wow factor and the necessity for this wow factor for us to be aware of it. You know, it's got to be here. It's got to come. Has to come. We need it. The world needs it. The collective spiritual sangha of the entire world needs it. Because the explanations that have been given out that I've been seeing about teachers doesn't quite have escape velocity to it. Does not. It's weak in certain areas. Some areas it's very good, other areas it's exploitable by belief. Okay, it is. Perfect certitude is not exploitable by belief. Okay, you could not exploit Ananda Mahima. It's impossible. Nobody could. Nobody ever did. And many tried, and many very powerful, famous people tried. Completely failed. Could not exploit it at all. But the teaching that I see in the world right now, I can see belief can exploit it. It really can. It's vulnerable to belief. There are ways that belief can go after it and exploit it and twist it and distort it and turn it. And so we are not in a safe situation. We are not in the best of situations at all. And that concerns me. When I look at a teacher, I look at their teaching, everything, I'm looking at the totality of it and seeing, you know, can belief exploit this? Are there areas where belief can undermine it? And then, you know, I can see that, yeah, there are areas, definitely are areas where it can be. So we do have to get something in the world that cannot be exploited by belief. Have to. And then that has to have a domino effect where collectively so many people just say, hey, their reality really is real and it cannot be exploited by belief at all. And you get this momentum going that way. And literally, you know, it can cause a tremendous Passover effect on this planet. Tremendous. Those who don't want that will certainly flee. And there may be a parting of the density fields. There really may be. The world may split into two, really, as far as dimensional vibration-wise. There really could be. That situation could take place. I don't know everything that's going to take place, but there could be a profound Passover effect taking place. So profound that we find ourselves, as it were, in a different world. Far, far better world as the other world flees from us. And as far as I know, this is going to take place because I've been prepared and clued into all of this way ahead of time. And yet, I don't have the particulars. I don't, like I say, I have no idea where any such perfect certitude could be hanging out in the world at this time. I was visited in a dream several days ago by a very, very odd being, I'll tell you that. Super unusual being. And I don't know if that being is perfect certitude or not. Very unexpected type of being. I'd never seen anyone like him before, ever. What wasn't an alien? It was not an alien. It wasn't not an ET. It was a human, you know, human type, but entirely different than anything I've ever, you know, I'm used to. They had something. They definitely were doing something that was very, very profound. Yeah, but I don't know if this how this will play out. And who knows, right? But if the expectations are right and the preparation is right and the willingness is right, there does need to be this effect activated of certitude in the world, that trickle down certitude needs to happen. And there's a question about, well, let us say that some famous teacher in the world, you know, there are some, of course, we know who they are. And you know, they're doing a pretty good thing. They're working with some certitude, absolutely, yeah. But let us say that those teachers, famous teachers, do not go to someone, you know, perfect certitude. Let us say, just hypothetically, someone, a perfect ambassador of certitude, a perfect certitude, is here in the world, and they start making themselves known, and there are those who get their bell rung and they're saying, hey, this is here, this is real, this is happening. Come on, you know, fast as possible, let's get with this trickle-down certitude effect. And that famous teacher does not go. They don't go to it. And we're looking at that famous teacher and we're saying, whoa, if they're not going to it, you know, maybe I shouldn't either. Maybe it's not good enough. You know, if it's not good enough for them, how could it be good enough for me? You would think that if it was really something this great, they would be going, and they don't. So we might say, oh, I'm going to wait until they go. But I just explained early in the video that oftentimes well-known teachers have such a profound situation of image and belief that is trying to, you know, work on them, it's super tough for them to admit or say or go to that situation, have their bell rung, you know, because it may just lift them up much higher. And there is a dynamic there that makes it very difficult for them. Not impossible by any means, because many of the gurus in India went to see Ramana or went to see Ananda Mayama. Many of them did. Not all. No, not all. Some of them, no way, because they could not admit that there could be anyone higher than them to go to. They could not admit it, and their devotees would not allow them to admit it. So there may very well be some bigwig spiritual movers and shakers here in this world who will not participate, at least at first. They won't necessarily be the first ones at all. It's probably going to be anonymous people or pretty much unknown people, you know. What do I have, like 150 subscribers and views are about, you know, 60 to 100 in these videos. It's super, 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 super small. And that's it. There's nothing else. So it may very well be people who are, you know, very small fish, who are the ones with nothing to lose, who'll say, hey, why not? I got nothing to lose. Because if I come on in here and say, hey, you know, trickle down certitude reached me, my spiritual bells are rung and everything, yeah, people, viewers will just say, hey, great, you know, and say, okay, good, you know, now we're getting somewhere, something like that. That's how I feel. I don't feel anyone's going to say, ah, you know, I thought you said you were perfect. How could you, you know, admit that you're not and all this kind of stuff? No, there's not any of that. So it probably will be the small fry that go first. And the big ones, at some point, they may get with it too. I expect they will. I mean, I don't see why not. There's some will not. There are some who are fraudulent. And, you know, for them to admit like everything they've done was just based on belief and not truth might be too much for them. I don't know. Maybe they can be rescued somehow. They need to be rescued from their devotees, because the devotees can be very dangerous. Can be very dangerous when they feel that their idol, you know, is going to be taken away from them, and the jig is up. But where they really have to do the hard work and get rid of their laziness, and they can be very dangerous, very dangerous. So sometimes maybe there's some teachers that will need to be rescued from that, which is possible. But again, the small fry probably going first, Maybe it'll be people, you know, you've hardly ever heard of at all. Maybe just a tiny little bit, you know, something like here is very tiny. And there may be others that just simply, you know, never said a word in this world. They've just been working too hard in preparation. And so you may look at those who are experiencing this trickle-down certitude, and you'll say, who are they, you know, who are they affiliated with? I mean, what have they ever done? You know, do they have some great teacher, or what's going on? And you will wonder about that, and you say, well, you know, Can I do it, you know? And, well, I said, well, if they can do it, then I can do it probably, right? The small fry, I'm a small fry, I can do it too. You don't need to wait for these big teachers to do it. Don't wait for them. There might be a subtle waiting for them, you know. I'm trying to look at this, you know, how it is. We're trying to say, well, you know, the big wigs have got to go first. We got to wait our turn. Again, the big wigs may be really struggling with some very strong efforts to hold them back, whereas the small fish, maybe not so much, you know. Belief has less to lose in that situation. The more famous you are, the more belief goes after you and tries to prevent you from perfect certitude, really. It's better to be anonymous. It's better to be a small fish at this time. It is really better. It's a blessing for me, you know, to be such a small fish. And no matter what I did in my life, there's no way I could be anything but a small fish. No way. There's just nothing happened at all to be anything but a very small fish. So nothing to lose on my account. And if you're like that, nothing to lose, you know. Hey, that's great. You're in the driver's seat. You are in the driver's seat. Trickle down certitude. Trickle down certitude. I don't know. That person that in the dream could be the one. I don't know. It's possible. It's really possible. I even asked their name, and they told me their name, and I had to repeat it over and over and over. Very unusual name. Very unusual name. Never heard that name before. And it means one who insulates, an insulator. That's what the name actually means. So, it's possible. It's really possible. But if it's true, I'll tell you, that person is very unassuming. Very unassuming. You would not at all associate perfect certitude with such a being, really. No. No. Nobody really would pay any attention to him. There's nothing striking at all about them. That's even somebody would be overlooked, really. They're unusual looking, for sure. But you know, you can't really place, you know, what it is and what unusual in what way. It's kind of like, huh, you know, I know, and just pass it by kind of thing. Belief will just pass it by. That's the impression I got. There's no extraordinary physical features or beauty or anything like that. No way. Not on the surface at all. No. Not glamorous at all, and zero glamorous, you know, looks at all. Very plain, or even more than plain, you know, just, you might even say unattractive, you know, plain to the point of being unattractive. That is true. But they had something, for sure. And it could very well have been certitude. That's pretty cool, you know, thinking about it. I'd kind of forgotten about that until I just started, you know, talking this video. I had a conversation. They came to my house. They were doing things and stuff, and it was very unassuming. This is not a glamorous person at all. Nobody would associate, you know, this is a spiritual being, you know, would not, from external appearances, would not come up with that at all. And if someone was just looking for spirituality, they would not see it there. They would not see it at all, because that's not what it is. Certitude is not spirituality. Okay? It's not. Spirituality comes from belief. Okay? Certitude comes from reality. And the one who is certain is different than spirituality and does not attract spirituality. It attracts those who are attracted towards certitude. Different thing. Different attraction. So I didn't see any spirituality attraction at all in this being that came in a dream. I didn't see any at all. None. No, nothing like that at all. And no possibility to really generate much of that at all around it. No way. But there was something there. There was something there for sure. Absolutely was something there. If I tell you what, it's a tremendous disguise. If this is actually the entity, the bastard of certitude, it is a terrific disguise. They are very heavily disguised, and there's a way that they're going to attract a following of spirituality. No way. This is someone who hardly even shows their face, you know, is not interested in even showing their face at all. So this is not a glamorous being who is here to wear, you know, the robes of spirituality and you know, fire everybody up with the charisma of spirituality. Not at all. This could be, you know, certitude. Certitude is different. Certitude, boom, you know, rings the bell. And just like that. And it's a whole different situation. Totally different situation. I mean, if you go to spiritual retreat, so it's all about spirituality, you know, you'll be able to know the difference. You know, you realize, wow, you know, this one really couldn't be a retreat leader. It's just not there at all, because it is so, you know, profound. Boom, you know, the bell's rung like that, and you're in it. You dove into the pool, and you know that's beyond any retreat, any spiritual retreat. It's already transcendent of that. It's transcendent of spirituality right off the bat. And you realize, hey, this is a different game. This is a different situation. This is a different situation. So I don't know. Maybe it's possible. I already met the person that's here, the being, the appearance of certitude in a dream. That is possible. I'm not sure. I really don't know for sure, because they were disguised. They're heavily disguised. Very unexpected. Very unassuming. Person. Totally unassuming. You know, it's kind of like the only way you would recognize anything is if you had expectations towards certitude. Otherwise, you just pass it by. Totally unassuming. Just pass it by. Ah, very interesting. Very interesting. Well, the times are extraordinary. The times are extraordinary. Really, if you are being here right now listening to this, you have to realize that you are extraordinary. Really extraordinary, because you're here right now in these times, and you're setting yourself up for a big boost, and the situation is one of just tremendously extraordinary times right now. And that's no joke. You know, you don't throw it away. Don't throw it away. You have to do your very best right now, because this is crunch time now. This is when the going gets tough, the tough get going. And we went to all this effort to get here. So don't throw it away. You know, hold on to it. Don't let it be pried out of your clasp. Because the best is yet to come. It is going to become like off the charts, you know, in uncharted territory. We are going into uncharted territory, and that is really great. That is really great. And it's doable. It is doable. I remember, there's this one golf course that had this, like, the highest reputation, a super reputation. It's supposed to be the hardest golf course in the world. It was unbelievable. And I was terrified of it. Terrified. And I thought I was going to my execution. And finally, I got up the courage after years and years and years and years. I finally went there. And I thought, oh, my God, it's going to destroy me. I was really terrified. Like, I thought I was going to die. I was so scared. And I got through it. And it was fantastic. I got beat up pretty bad, but nothing like I thought. I was able to get through it, you know, because I really prepared for years and years and years. It's like, wow, that was incredible. It was just mind-blowing. And then I went back to it one other time after preparing many more years of playing, and it was no problem at all for me. No problem at all. It wasn't that difficult. But it goes to show you that there can be something that is really extraordinary, and you can prepare for it, and you can be scared of it, but you can do it. It's uncharted territory. It is uncharted, but you can do it. You absolutely can do it. Just a little bit of help, You know, just a little bit of encouragement is enough. I got a little bit of encouragement. And with that little bit of encouragement, you know, I said, well, you know, here goes nothing. And it was going into uncharted territory, thinking it's going to be overwhelming. It wasn't overwhelming. It was beautiful. It was fabulous. Just fabulous, I'm telling you. Left an indelible mark, you know. It's just, wow. It's like that. We are headed for those times where we will have an indelible mark left on us of going into these uncharted territory and experiencing something that is so tremendous that, you know, we will be so happy that we didn't miss it. So happy. We'll say, wow, it'll just open up vistas to us that were closed before, that we didn't think was possible. Vistas beyond belief will open up for us. And not in a threatening way at all. No way. No, no, no. Beautiful. That, you know, the wow factor will just be there. It'll just be there for us. So whatever you do, you cling to that. To the, you're exceptional. You're extraordinary. You're incredible. You've made it this far. And here you are getting ready to go into even better situation. And just stay with that, yeah. Stay with that extraordinariness. You don't have to do, you know, you don't have to do anything crazy at this point at all. No, just hang in there. Just hang in there. Just hang in there. Continue, you know, your efforts. Those of you who are used to making effort will continue your efforts, you know. But you don't have to, like, pull an all-nighter. You know, you don't have to go a week of meditation all, you know, 24 hours a day. You don't have to do that. You just have to hang in there, continue with your clarification, keep feeling okay with it, and the best is yet to come. It's the best of times and the worst of times. If you find a super great place in this world, you know, or situation, you will find that very few people will go there. I've had that happen to me a number of times where I found places that were just incredibly beautiful and peaceful, etc., and I couldn't get anyone to go there. You know, very difficult. Occasionally, you know, some you can get some people to go occasionally. It's possible. So don't think like the situation is going to be overwhelming, you know. No, not necessarily. Not necessarily. It's not going to be, you know, just a mad rush, you know, of billions of people or something. No, 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 no. When you have someone who's totally unassuming, perfect certitude, totally unassuming, you're not going to have a mad rush. Those who are into spirituality aren't going to gravitate towards that. You know, the gravitation is for those who have prepared for meeting up with certitude, for getting comfortable with certitude. Those are the ones who will initially, you know, go for it. And those numbers are not, you know, huge. And gradually the dominoes will increase, you know, like a pyramid effect coming down from the top. As certitude trickles down, it will pyramid itself for sure. It will get bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger and trickle down. But initially, no, it won't be that like that. So you don't have to worry. You don't have to really worry. You know, just like it's not going to be overly intense in a world situation type of way. So just hang in there. Just hang in there. Stay with it, truth, and the truth will stay with you. That is a fact. All right. Very great. Let's end this video now.